days and really trying to help us to understand what is going to be happening, what is going to be going on in the last days. And God has given us the Bible to illuminate our eyes, to make us aware what is going to be happening in the world, what's going to be happening in these last days. And I know a lot of us, sometimes we have a hard time to wrap our mind around these things, that we are living in the last days. And you say, Pastor Mike, how do you know? Well, the Bible declares this very explicitly in the Word of God. The Word of God is very distinct, very clear of the things that have conspired that we are living in the very last days. And I know a lot of people kind of want to just sweep this under the rug. We want to kind of make pretend that we have all this extra time. And the Bible says it's very clear that our salvation is nearer when we first believe. And the day is at hand and the night is far spent. So we have to be aware of what is going on all around us, what's happening in our culture, what's happening in the world. And the Bible speaks very explicitly of Jesus Christ. He tells us very clearly what is going to be happening in the last days in Matthew chapter 24. Throughout the Word of God is always pointing us to the last days, what is going to be happening, what is going to be going on in the world, what is going to happen with the culture of the people. And these are the very things that we have to be aware of when we study the Bible, we read the Word of God, and we look into the principles of what's going to be happening in the very last days. And so when we open up the Bible, we turn to Matthew chapter 24, and we look at this, and the disciples ask Jesus Christ a very clear question. They ask him, what is going to be the sign of his coming and the end of the world? So in Matthew chapter 24, and let's just look at this really quick, and we began this study last week, and so let's pick it up in verse 1, Matthew 24 and verse 1. And Jesus went out, and he departed from the temple unto the disciples. They came to him to show him the building of the temple. And as Jesus said unto them, see not all these things. Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, disciples came to him privily, saying, tell us, when shall all these things be? And everyone say that out loud, the latter part of that verse, and what? And the end of the world, you see? So they asked the disciples, what's going to be the sign of your coming and what's going to be the signs of the end of the world? And then Jesus goes on and he begins to address what's going to be their question in verse 4. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man what? Deceive you. Now, the first thing that he addresses, we talked about this last week, is the deception. That is first and foremost, the number one issue that he addresses is that there is going to sweep across the world a spiritual deception where people will be led astray, where people will be led astray from the truth of the very Word of God, that they will be deceived. That is the thing that we're facing right now, is a great spirit of deception, and that spirit of deception is based in religion, and it's based in tradition, and it's based in formalism, where people are literally have just been totally deceived into believing things that are contrary to the authority of the Word of God. If they ask Jesus Christ this question, and Jesus Christ is answering this question, and the first thing he addresses is the deception that is taking place in this world, that means that it's the first and foremost and prevalent issue that is taking place towards the end of the world. Now notice what Jesus says in verse 5, right? Look at what it says here, right? He says here, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and say it out loud, shall what? Deceive many, okay? So the first issue that we have to deal with is this spirit of deception. And last week we began to talk about it briefly, but I want to show you a couple other things. So I want you to turn to 1 John in chapter 4 and verse 1. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 1. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. Now it says here, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they be of God. Because many, say it out loud, many what? False prophets are gone out into the world. And we've seen that no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into what? An angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers be transformed as ministers of righteousness. And so we begin to talk about that. Jesus says, and many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ. And and they shall what? Deceive many. And so we have to realize is that there is a spiritual deception taking place in our world and in our culture, and it's based on religion. It's based on corrupt Bibles. It's based on preachers that are preaching another gospel. It's based on a gospel that is taught through salvation, through works. It is based on all formalism and tradition that is leading people astray. And if the old expression is, if you can't beat them, what does the devil do? You join them. And so Satan is a deceiver. He's nothing more than a counterfeiter. And he has counterfeited the Bible. He has counterfeited churches. He's got a counterfeit pastors. He's got counterfeit religion. He's got a counterfeit of everything that the Lord Jesus Christ is doing. And so it says here in 1 John, beloved, we're not to believe every spirit, but we're to what? Try the spirits, whether they be of God. You and I have to learn how to try and to test the spirits of God. And if it doesn't line up with the word of God, it is a false spirit, okay? It doesn't matter what they say. It doesn't matter how moral or how cultural they seem. It doesn't even matter how faithful they appear to be to that own religion. But if it doesn't line up with the word of God, it is a false spirit, okay? Now notice this, because many false prophets have gone out into the world, okay? So now I want you to do this. I want you to turn to the book of Galatians, because I want to show you something in the book of Galatians, okay? Galatians chapter 1, and we'll pick it right up in verse 6. Galatians chapter 1 and in verse 6. Galatians chapter 1 and verse 6. So if you study the word of God, the Apostle Paul, in the majority of his writings, he's constantly addressing false churches and false religions. It's something that you cannot get away from in the word of God. And when you study the word of God as a whole, you're going to see a theme that runs throughout the entire word of God, and it's dealing with false preachers, false prophets, and false pastors and false religions throughout the whole word of God. Because that is the number one dilemma that we face in the world today. When you finally get to the book of Revelation and we see the woman that in Revelation 17, the whorish woman, the mother whore, she sits upon many waters. That is encompassed with a false church and a false religion. That is what leads people astray, is false teachings. It's a corrupt Bible. It's a corrupt translation of the word of God. It's religious beliefs that lead people astray and damns people's souls to an eternal hell. Now watch this. In Galatians chapter 1 and verse 6, Galatians 1 and verse 6, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you unto the grace of Christ unto another what? Gospel. Now watch what he says in verse 7, which is not another, but there be some that would trouble you, and say that all out loud, they would what? They would pervert the gospel of Christ. Did you see that? They've taken the word of God and they've literally perverted the gospel. You say, how could somebody pervert the gospel? The gospel means good news. Well, what is the gospel? It's the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's the gospel is that Christ saved us by grace, and we saved through faith, not of ourselves. It's the what? The gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. That is the gospel. It's the good news that Jesus Christ came to this world to redeem lost sinners like you and I, to save our souls from eternal hell, to redeem us with his blood, to purchase us with his blood. That is the gospel. But yet there are people that have taken the gospel and they've twisted it and they've perverted the gospel. Well, how do they do that? It's because they teach a gospel by works. That's what they do. They teach a gospel that salvation will be based on works or tradition or religion or the sacraments or the communion or some other sort of thing, not through grace only. That is a perverted gospel. We live in a culture today where people have taken the word of God and they've perverted the very gospel of Jesus Christ. They perverted the simple message of salvation and redemption. They've perverted and they've altered it through tradition and through religion. That's how they've perverted the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now let's look at this, right? He says in verse 7 again, which is not another, but there would be some that would trouble you. You see that? They're going to trouble you, and they would pervert the gospel of Christ. Now notice what he says in verse 8. But though we, meaning himself or any of his other followers, though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which ye have preached unto you, let him be a what? A curse. Do you see that? Paul says, if anyone's preaching any other gospel, that person should be what? accursed. Do you guys see how clear that is in the scripture? Well, what is another gospel? You want to know what another gospel is? The Roman Catholicism teaches another gospel. The Jehovah Witnesses teach another gospel. The Mormons teach another gospel. The Latter-day Saints teach another gospel. There are churches all over this country and all over this state, with right in here in Massachusetts, that are teaching another gospel. They are teaching what is called a social gospel. That is a gospel, is that you get to heaven by what you do. That is another gospel. They teach a gospel that you get saved and you can earn your way to salvation and you can earn your way to heaven based on a religion or based on baptism or communion or sacraments. That is another gospel, and those people are cursed. That's what the Bible says. I didn't say it. You guys said it out loud. Let him be a what? Latter part of verse 8? Accursed. Now watch this, right? That was good. Who said that? verse 9, right? As we have said, look at verse 8. But though we or another gospel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you, which we have not preached, right, let him be accursed. Now look at verse 9. As we have said before, so say now I again, right? Now watch this. If any man preach, he says it twice, another gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be a what? Accursed. Now watch this, right? For do I now persuade men, or do I seek to please? Persuade men or God? Or if I seek to please men, for if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. So what we have is that we have a social gospel that is being preached. That social gospel is a gospel that is contrary to the truth of the very word of God. That social gospel, it's a gospel of religion. It's a gospel of tradition. It's a gospel of formalism. It's a gospel of ceremonialism. It's a gospel that is not the truth, and it's a cursed gospel. And a lot of people don't realize this. Even some Christians, they kind of fall into this category thinking, well, all of these religions are good and all of these churches are good. Then why did Jesus give warnings over and over about churches and about religions and about formalism and tradition? Why is it then that the Lord Jesus Christ and that the Apostle Paul and Peter, they address these issues continually, that there will be in the last days what? Deceivers, and people are going to be deceived. This is what we're facing right now. And now let's look at this a little bit further. So Galatians, right, chapter 3 now. Watch this. Turn to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 1. Now watch what he says here. Paul says, O foolish Galatians, look at the word that he uses. Who has what? Who has bewitched you? Who's deceived you? Who has used some sort of trickery? Who has literally caused you to think something contrary to the truth of the very word of God? Who has bewitched you? Who has put a spell upon you? Who has taken your mind and literally put some sort of spell on you that caused you to believe something that is contrary to the truth of the word of God? And there are people all around this area, and you have family members and friends, they have been bewitched into believing something that is not true. They have been bewitched into believing a false gospel. They have been bewitched into believing something contrary to the truth of the word of God. They have been deceived in not believing the authority of the scriptures of the King James Bible. They have been deceived and they have been bewitched, and they've been led astray by a religion, by a tradition, by some sort of ceremonialism. Those are the things that Christ is talking about. He says, who has bewitched you that ye should not obey the what? The truth. They were deceived and from believing the truth. And if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the god of this world has blinded the what? The minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel should shine unto them. They've been bewitched. They don't obey the truth. They've been led astray from the truth. Now, the Satan's objective is to lead people away from the truth, okay? And who is the truth? Jesus is the truth. What is the truth? Thy word is truth. And what does the enemy want to do? He wants to corrupt and pervert the truth. He wants to corrupt and pervert the truth of the word of God. He wants to corrupt and pervert people from seeing Jesus Christ as the essence of truth and who he really is in his character, in the essence of his being. And we look at this a little bit further, right? Before whose eyes Jesus Christ has been evidently set forth, crucified among you, All right, now stay with me, right? We're going to try to tie this together, and then next week we'll look at some other things in the last days, but I want you to turn to 2 Timothy chapter 4. Most of us know these scriptures very well, but it's good to us to look at them again. 2 Timothy chapter 4 in verse 1. 2 Timothy chapter 4 in verse 1. Watch this. Paul is writing to young Timothy. He says, I charge thee, I'm holding this to your account, Timothy, therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick, that's the living and the dead. Those are the people that are dead, spiritually speaking as well, at his appearing and his kingdom. Notice that, his appearing and his kingdom. That is when he comes back to establish his heavenly reign on this earth, okay? When he comes back to establish the kingdom in Jerusalem. Now watch this. He says, preach the word, be instant, in season, out of season. Notice what he tells them to do. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. But he's telling young Timothy, Timothy, you preach the word, all right? You preach it in season and out of season, rebuke and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come where they will not endure. Say it out loud. Sound what? Sound doctrine. Do you see that? He's saying there's going to come a time in this world where they will not listen to sound biblical expositional preaching, where they will not listen to sound biblical doctrine, where the people do not want to hear sound biblical doctrine. We're living in a culture today where people don't want to deal with the truth of the Word of God. That's why you have these mega churches. Now watch what he says in here. Stay with me. Watch this. All right, he says, preach the word, be instant, in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come where they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having what? Itching ears. You see that? Those are the mega churches that he's talking about in the context. The time will come where they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust, in other words, what they want to hear, the social gospel or the prosperity gospel that is being preached all over our country right now. The time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but they will heap to themselves. The heap means masses of people. All right, they will heap to themselves, masses of people, right? And they're going to heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. In other words, they're people that are just going to tickle their ears and not tell them what they really need to hear. You don't see preachers preaching on hell and the second coming of Jesus Christ and the eternal damnation of lost people. Why? Because they don't want to talk about those things. They don't want to talk about the false prophets because that's who they are. They won't tell you about the return of Jesus Christ, and out of his mouth is going to come a sharp two-edged sword that he's going to smite the nations. They don't talk about that. You don't want to know why? Because they're false teachers. They're false teachers. They're not going to talk about the wrath of Almighty God and the judgment of Almighty God. They're going to talk, all they're going to do is use the some similitude of the Word of God to bring forth some sort of social gospel and to bring some sort of message of prosperity and growth and wealth and all this nonsense that's being preached and taught. Last week we drew out all the characters and we mentioned their name, and I know some people say, you shouldn't do that. And yeah, the Bible says, mock them which what? Cause divisions. You know what Jesus did? He pointed them out. You know what the Apostle Paul did? He pointed them out. And we'll point them out. The Joel Osteens, the Cleflo Dollars, the Joyce Myers, the whole bunch of them. You can go down the line. They're false prophets. They're false teachers. You warn them. The Bible, Jesus Christ warned the people about the Pharisees over and over and over. He pointed them out. He singled them out, and he pointed their finger. Jesus literally pointed his finger at them. And he told them that they're false teachers in front of the crowd. And I know a lot of people think, oh, you shouldn't do such things. Well, yes, you should. If somebody's perverting the gospel, if somebody's teaching a perverted gospel, do you point them out? If somebody's a sexual predator, what do? They point them out, don't they? They have their picture up at the police station, or they mock them. Now watch this, right? Verse 3 again, for the time will come where they will not endure sound doctrine. They won't listen to sound biblical doctrine. But after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. Now look at verse 4. This is the last days, guys. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned to what? Fables. All right, thy word is what? Truth. You know what they're going to do? They're going to turn away their ears from the truth of the word of God, and they want to hear stories and parables and fables. That's what they want. They want to hear. They don't want to hear the truth. So people will go to these mega churches, right? And where the preacher will give them a sermon or a message that literally is appealing to them, to make them feel good. That's the culture we're living in. That's where we're at right now. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1 through 8, turn there really quick, right? Because this is where we're going to start tying all of this together, so stay with me, right? Now, notice this, right? 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1 through 8. And we're gonna read all of it, but we're going to focus in on verses 7 and 8 is going to be our primary focal point. But I just want you to, I want to address this because this helps keep the context of what we're looking at, okay? Number one, all right, verse 1. This know also that in the last what? Last days, perilous times to come, okay? So Paul is writing to young Timothy about the last days, about what's going to be happening in the last days, okay? Now watch this. Knowing this first, that perilous times shall come, right? We know this, right? They're going to come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, right? Covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemies, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Now, you can't tell me that we're not living in the last days just by reading those few verses there, okay? Now, watch this. Having a form of godliness. You see that? So they have this outward form of godliness, but denying the power. See that? But denying the power thereof. And then he tells us clearly, from such, say it out loud, turn away. Now watch this, because verse 6 and 7 and 8 are our key. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts. Now watch what it says. Ever learning and never able to come to a knowledge of the what? Did you see that? So you've got people out there, they're just learning. They go to church week after week after week. They're ever learning, but they're never able to come to a knowledge of the what? You see that? That is the culture that we're living in, where people are constantly learning. We have information flooding our minds, and information wherever we go. You can learn, ever learning, but never able to come to a knowledge of the what? The truth. Well, who is the truth? Jesus says, I am the way, the what? The truth and the life. No man can come to the Father but what? Through me. Thy word is truth. In the authority Bible, King James Bible, thy word is truth. So you have these people that are constantly learning and they're constantly developing, but they're never able to come to a knowledge of the truth. In other words, the knowledge of the truth is redemption. The knowledge of the truth is salvation. The knowledge of the truth is when you get born again, you've come to a knowledge of the truth of who Jesus Christ is. You come to a knowledge of the truth that Jesus Christ died for your sins and that he is the only way to God through Jesus Christ. In no other way can you be redeemed outside of the truth of God's word. And yet there are people that study the Bible, read the Bible, hold up a Bible, carry a Bible. Well, they don't carry a real Bible, but they carry a corrupt thing. But that's a whole nother message. But they're never able to come to a knowledge of the what? Of the truth. Now, stay with me because this is where it gets important, okay? All right, so when you study the Bible, we have words that are the most important words in the Bible because they draw out a what? A comparison. Come on, you guys, my discipleship two students. What are the two most important words in the Bible? As and like, okay, good. As and like, because they give us a what? A comparison and an illustration, okay? So now let's look at this, right? And here it says here, now look at verse 7 again. Ever learning and never able to come to a knowledge of the truth. Now the Apostle Paul gives us a metaphor. He gives us an illustration from the Old Testament. Now notice what he says in verse 8. Now, as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. Now, does anyone know who Jannes and Jambres are? Okay, those were the individuals. They were Pharaoh's what? Magicians. You guys remember that? And you remember Moses took the serpent and he put it down and they said, oh, big deal. And what did they do? They took a serpent, they took a pole and they put it down and it turned into a snake as well. Moses took the staff that God gave him, he put it on the ground, and it turned into a snake, and then they took a staff, and they put it on the ground, and it turned into a snake as well. But the good thing about it, what happened? Moses' king cobra come along and ate those other snakes up. And then when Moses turned the water into blood, what did they do? They did the same thing. So no, you guys with me now? So the word as, he says, now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so did these resist the truth. You know how they resist the truth? By mimicking the truth. By coming up with something that is mimicking the truth. This is what he's talking about. See, as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, well, how did they withstand Moses? By counterfeiting what God was doing. Did you guys get that? Satan is nothing more than a counterfeit. When you see religions and churches and buildings out there, and they are nothing more than a counterfeit of the truth of the very word of God. Why do you think there are so many different Bibles? Because Satan says, well, if God has a Bible, I've got to counterfeit the Bible. Satan is nothing more than a counterfeit. That's why there are so many denominations. That's why there's so many religions. That's why you have so many things going on television. They are what? They are nothing more than a counterfeit. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into a what? An angel of what? Light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers be transformed as ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. So now, as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses through what? Through trickery, by bewitching the people, by deceiving the people through a counterfeit, so do these also resist the truth. So how do they resist the truth? By counterfeiting the truth. And it says, men of what? Corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. You know what a reprobate is? Somebody who claimed to be a Christian and who reality wasn't. That is called a reprobate. They're reprobates. Now, stay with me. And everything that we just looked at, store it in the back of your mind, because here's how we have to tie it all together, okay? So don't forget what we just looked at, the scriptures that we just looked at, especially Jannes and Jambres. Now watch this. Go to the book of Jeremiah, right? Chapter 5. Jeremiah chapter 5 and verse 30. Now notice what Jeremiah says here. I want you to really pay attention to the wording on how Jeremiah speaks under the anointing of the Lord in the context of the historical aspect of this. Jeremiah chapter 5 and verse 30. He says, a wonderful and a horrible thing is committed in the land. Now, the word wonderful, it's not the way we would use the word wonderful, like, oh, this is wonderful. It's a wonderful day. The sun is shining. No, no, no. It means like an enlarged issue, okay? Jeremiah chapter 5 and verse 30. A wonderful and horrible thing is committed in the land. So what is the wonderful, horrible thing? What is the massive, horrible thing that is committed in the land? Jeremiah, what is the issue? What is the horrible and the horrific thing that is committed in the land? What is the problem, Jeremiah? Jeremiah, what is the issue? And then now Jeremiah is going to give us the answer. So stay with me. Watch this. A wonderful and horrible thing is committed in the land. The prophets prophesy, say it out loud, everyone, falsely, and the priests bear rule by their means, and my people, say it out loud, go ahead. Did you guys hear that? The issue was, is that the priests were telling everyone lies, and the people, say it out loud, they love to hear it. They love it. You look at Joel Osteen, and he's up there, and he's telling all this nonsense, and hopefully, God, you don't ever watch him. But anyways, that's a whole other story. Some people say, I thought he was good. No, no, no. Listen, and the people, they what? They love to hear it. This is your best life, and you're just wonderful, and everything's going to be great. Yeah, let's increase our joy and all that nonsense. Listen. This is a horrible thing, he's saying here. Well, what is the wonderful, what is the horrible thing that the people, the priests and the prophets, they were lying to the people. They weren't telling them the truth, and they didn't bear rule by their means, and my people love to have it so. We live in a culture today where people want to be lied to. You think I'm kidding? We know from studying the Bible, history repeats itself, does it not? Human nature never changed. You know something? Some of you even want to come in here and have me tell you how wonderful you are one morning. Well, guess what? I'm not going to do it. Because my Bible says that in you dwelleth what? No good thing. My Bible says your heart is what? It's desperately wicked. It's deceitful above what? All things. My Bible says there's none that doeth good, no, not one. So don't think you can stand up and say, I'm that one, Preacher Mike, because you're not. My Bible says all your righteousness are is what? Filthy rags. You see that? My Bible even says, you know, these guys preaching that prosperity gospel, my Bible says he that seeketh to be rich has a what? An evil eye. But you know what people want to do? They want people to prophesy lies unto them. They don't want to hear the truth. This is why they'll go to this church or that church or this church. They don't want to come to a church like this. They don't want to hear the truth. They don't want to hear how sinful they are. They don't want to hear that if they don't get born again, they're going to burn for hell, in hell for all of eternity. They don't want to hear that. This is a horrible thing that is committed in the land. The prophets and the priests, they prophesy falsely. And your priests bear rule by their means. And my people love to have it so. And what will ye do in the end thereof? What are you going to do in the end? Look at Jeremiah 14:4. Jeremiah 14:4. Watch this. You guys think that this, like, guys, this is the main theme that runs through the Bible. Don't think that, like, you know, I popped up in the air with this. Guys, this stuff is taught throughout the whole Word of God. Look at what it says over here in Jeremiah, right? Jeremiah 14:14, right? Then the Lord said unto me, all right? This is what God is speaking to Jeremiah. Then the Lord said unto me, the prophets prophesy, say it aloud, what? Lies in my name. Notice that they were prophesying lies in the name of God. And God tells them, I say it out loud, I what? He says, I sent them not. Neither have I commanded them. Look at this. Neither spake unto them. He's, look at this. I didn't even speak unto them. They prophesy unto you a what? A false vision and deviations and a thing of naught. And look at this. And deceit of their what? And the deceit of their own heart. You imagine that? That these guys, you have to understand, these false prophets, they didn't come from God. You see, they were risen up to tell the people what they wanted to hear. You say, well, why would that happen? I'm going to show you why. Stay with me. Look at Isaiah chapter, go to Isaiah 30 verse 8. Isaiah 30 verse 8. Isaiah chapter 30 and verse 8. Now watch this. Now go write it before them in a table and note it in a book that it may be for the time to come forever and ever. So he's told to write this down in a book so that it would be there forever and ever. Verse 9, that this is a rebellious people, lying children, children that will not, say it out loud, hear the law of the Lord. Now watch this. Which say to the seers, those were the people that would see into the future, they would say to the seers, say, look what they would say, see not, and to the prophets, say it out loud, prophesy not unto us right things, speak unto us what? Smooth things, tickle our ears, smooth it over, prophesy unto us what? Deceit, tell us a bunch of lies. We live in a country and a culture today where people go to church to be lied to. Because people don't want the truth, and they want to go in there, and they want some preacher to tell them how everything's going to be wonderful and how God wants to make them wealthy and prosperous. Listen, that's what people want to hear, and because they wanted to hear that, God rose up the false prophet, and he put a lying spirit in their mouth. Our hearts are so wicked and deceitful that we don't even want to hear the truth of God's word. That's a scary thought, isn't it? I mean, look what the people were saying, verse 10 again. Which say to the seers, see not, don't tell us what's going to happen in the future. Don't tell us about God's judgment. Don't tell us about God's wrath. Don't tell us about his indignation. Don't tell us about the Chaldeans and the Persians and the Babylonians going to overthrow us. Don't tell us that. Tell us everything's going to be wonderful. Which say to the seers, see not. And to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things. Don't tell us the truth, preacher. Pastor Mike, make me feel good. Watch this. Prophesy not unto us right things. Speak unto us what? Just smooth it over. Will you please just smooth it over? Just smooth it all over. don't talk about hell. Don't talk about my family members who've never been born again that are going to burn for eternity. Don't talk about that. Just smooth it over, Pastor Mike. I'm not going to smooth it over. If I seek to please men, I shall not be the what? The servant of Christ. My duty is to tell you the truth, not to make you feel good. And if you know the truth shall what? Set you free. Prophesy. You can imagine the people literally saying this. History never changes. Listen, guys, the only thing we don't learn from history is what? We don't learn anything from history. History repeats itself. Human nature repeats itself. They were saying, prophesy not unto us right things. Speak unto us smooth things. Prophesy unto us what? Deceit. Look at they were saying, get you out of the way. Turn aside the path. Cause the Holy One of Israel to what? Cease from before us. Don't tell us the truth. Don't talk about hell, the judgment of God. Don't talk about those things. Now watch how all of this works. Let's tie this all together. 1 Kings chapter 22. 1 Kings chapter 22. First Kings chapter 22, verse 23. 1 Kings 22, verse 23. Now watch this, right? Now therefore, behold, stay with me, the Lord has put a lying spirit in the mouth of all these prophets. Let me ask you the question. Who put a lying spirit in the mouth of the prophets? Who did it? Who put the lying spirit in the mouth of the prophets? It was the Lord. Does everyone see that? You say, well, why would God do that? Because the people didn't want the truth. Did you guys get it? Listen, God will give you whatever you want. You don't want to believe the truth? God's not going to force you to believe the truth. You want to believe a lie? You want to believe that you're good enough to go to heaven? God will let you believe that. You want to believe that your baptism, your morality, your communion, that something you've done in this world can get you into heaven? If you want to believe that because a lying spirit told you that, you will die in your sins and go to hell. But God will let you believe what you want to believe. If you don't want the truth, God's not going to force the truth on you. Now remember, God has written the laws of God where? In your heart. Remember that? God has given you a conscience. God has revealed truth to you over and over and over. But men still want to reject the truth because of their pride and because of their stubbornness. When somebody rejects the truth, you have to understand, the laws of God are written in their heart. Number one, right? God has given every man a measure of what? Faith. We understand that. God has dealt to every man a measure of faith. God has given them a conscience. God has given them creation. God has showed them through the Holy Spirit of God that there is one way of salvation, that there's only one means of redemption. But because of their pride in their religion, or because of their pride in their self-righteousness, they will be damned to hell because they choose to reject God's free gift of salvation. And you want to know why people don't want the truth? It's because of stubborn pride. That's what it comes down to. Because now they have to face and be like, I was wrong all these years. Yes, Mom, you were wrong all those years. Yes, Dad, you were wrong all those years. Well, what about this? What about that? I can't believe that. Well, you better believe it. Now look at this verse again. Now therefore, behold, the Lord hath put a lying spirit in the mouth of all these prophets, and the Lord has spoken evil concerning thee. So God put the lying spirit in the mouth of the prophets. Now let's look at one more verse of scripture and we'll tie it all together. Go to the book of Ezekiel, Ezekiel chapter 14, Ezekiel chapter 14. Ezekiel chapter 14, and we'll pick it right up in verse 9. Ezekiel chapter 14 and verse 9. Now watch this. And if the prophet be deceived when he has spoken a thing, say it out loud. Who deceived the prophet? The Lord deceived him. Wait a second, Pastor Mike. God would deceive somebody? Yes, God would. Hey, listen, the Bible says in Romans chapter 1, God will give them over to what? A reprobate mind. The Bible says over there in Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians, it's because God will send them a what? A strong delusion that they should what? Believe a lie. When you start to mess with that book and you start to mess with truth, let me tell you something, God will send you a lie to believe a lie. We're living in a culture, in a country today. We're living in a society today where there are false prophets, and they were risen up, and God put a lying spirit in the mouth of those false prophets, right? Why? It's because people don't want the truth any longer. And the more people don't want the truth, right? The way the culture's going, the less people want to hear the truth, the less they want to be convicted, the less they want to hear about their sin, the less they want to hear about God's wrath and his indignation and his judgment. Listen, guys, the whole Bible points to the return of Jesus Christ, and it's a day of wrath, and it's a day of indignation, and it's a day of judgment. You can't get around it. There is no other way. And any preacher that is not preaching the climax of the Word of God is not preaching the truth. That's the bottom line. You say, Pastor Mike, that's all you talk about. Yes, because that is the main crux of the message. Is the return of Jesus Christ. All of human history, all of the Bible climaxes to this main event, where the wrath and the indignation of a holy and a righteous God, his judgment will be poured out upon this world. And we're going to sit here talking about a prosperity gospel? You're either a deceiver or you're completely insane. And I don't think they're insane. I believe they've been totally deceived. You got all these guys out there. We can go down a list. We went down that list, man. Boom, boom, boom. They're all false prophets. If they don't preach on hell and the return of Jesus Christ and God's judgment, let me tell you something, they're a false prophet. And they're out there just tickling people's ears. And you know what the people do? Prophesy unto us smooth things. Prophesy unto us deceit. Make us feel good. In the latter times, they're going to give heed to themselves, teachers having what? Itching ears. And they will turn away their ears from the truth and will be turned to what? Fables. The number one problem that we're facing right now, you say, Pastor Mike, we got the economy, we got this, we got all these problems going on in the world. Let me tell you, the number one problem is the false teachers. It was the first thing Jesus dealt with when they asked him, Lord, what is it going to be like at the end of the world and before you return? What is it going to be like? Jesus says the first thing he addressed was what? The false teachers. That tells me that that's going to be the real crux of the problem. It's going to be the main issue that we're facing. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Lord, we just thank you and praise you for who you are. We thank you for the truth of your word. We thank you for allowing us to read it, to study it, to show us the truth, Lord. And help us, Lord, to try the spirits, whether they be of God, because many false prophets have gone out into this world, and over, Jesus mocked them. The Apostle Paul pointed them out, Alexander the coppersmith and other people, how he just would label those people that did him much harm. And Lord, I know that we live in a country and a culture today where we're not supposed to be offensive or hurtful to people. People are trying to be so overly sensitive, but it's just another way of diminishing the truth of your word. And Lord, we just pray, God, I pray for your people here that they'll stand strong, that you give them conviction to stand against the false teachings that are out there, even that their family members have fallen into, where people just, even Christians don't want to hear the truth any longer. They want to go to a church that is going to be appealing to them and make them feel good. We don't go to church to feel good. We go to church to learn the truth of your word. Lord, we just thank you for the Bible, the authority of the King James Bible. Thank you for giving it to us, Lord, and preserving your word.